Bueno, chicos, bienvenidos al canal, bienvenidos de nuevo al Corner. Hoy os traemos un contenido un tanto especial, hoy os traemos una entrevista con un futbolista profesional. Los que nos sigáis a través de redes sociales habréis seguido paso a paso la historia. Jugamos un torneo de FIFA y a raíz de ello pues hemos conocido a este gran futbolista y gran persona. Tengo conmigo hoy el placer y le presento ya, bueno, Marcus, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I would say ¿cómo estás? That's basically the extent of my knowledge in Spanish, but I'm doing very well. I'm very excited to be on your podcast.
Well, as you can see, I'm not brave enough to pronounce your last name. If you can pronounce it for
yeah,
me.
It has a bit of an unfamiliar letter in it, but it's Fjortoft. Fjortoft, okay. Yes, very good.
I think that's all we need to know to start the interview. Well, first of all, thanks for making this happen. You have been so nice with us via Twitter and via WhatsApp. You have been so nice with us, and we are glad to have you here.
The pleasure is all mine, man. You guys reached out, and it was actually very entertaining and fun for me to see the tweets because I didn't have any idea about the context. I just saw something in Spanish. Obviously, I can translate on Twitter, and then you explained it to me, and I saw through the tweets. And it was actually pretty funny to see because I don't think a player rated 55 gets that much love on FIFA. So I'm pretty happy about that.
I can tell you were outstanding on the tournament.
Yeah.
It was crazy. We reached the final with Hamilton. It was like a surprise for everyone. And you were our captain and our leader. And
good, your first reaction. Was it good in the air then, huh? Good physique?
Yeah, and tackles. It was crazy. I mean, you were like Van Dijk. Crazy.
The closest I come to Van Dijk is my ponytail, so that's the closest I get, but I'll take it.
So your first reaction when you saw the tweet, it was like, well, these
you know, people, I just saw my timeline and I'm just, what the fuck is this? I don't know what's going on. It's something in Spanish and I see my Hamilton picture and then I look through the translation and I said, this is amazing because it's pretty funny, pretty random, not going to lie. Yeah. And then I see you guys respond to my tweet because I said, I have no idea about the context, but I'm honored that I'm such a fan favorite because that's the closest I think Hamilton will get to winning a title. But don't tell them I said that. But let's just say we're not used to being in cup finals. So that was fun to see that Hamilton got a run. And then the fact that I was such an important player for you guys, that brought a bit of joy to my day.
That's crazy. Well, the first question is, how are you doing? Because we are, worldwide, we're getting through a strange time. Yeah. How are you doing? How are you dealing with this quarantine? Where are you now?
No, I'm in Norway now at home because I'm from Norwegian. I left Scotland 1.5 months ago. We were about to play a game the next day and then it all hit. So I've been home enjoying my time at home. Obviously, you have to be in quarantine and you've got to be careful. But in Norway, they're opening things up. Norway's been, thankfully enough, they've dealt with it pretty well. So I've just been working out and enjoying my time with family. And now that you can open up, you can meet with friends. I just worked out with a friend in a park and you can do that. So it's nice being home, but it's obviously weird being in a state of limbo as to when you start the season again because you don't know. And you start by finishing the season or do you cancel it and start the next season again? So you've got an extended vacation, so to speak, but it's weird not knowing when to start again because you don't know how should I train? Should I train up to this date? Should I give myself the rest now? You don't really know how to balance it, and that feels a bit weird. And then you're looking through Twitter and then you're looking through statements and then you see the Premier League starting, but does the Scotland start? Yeah. You don't know. So, but I draw my time at home and this is the card we're dealt with, and then I make the most out of it. You can't, there's no other choice for me, really.
Yeah, that's what we have to do. Stay at home, really. It's easy
and
for
Spain,
us.
In Spain, it's, Norway count themselves very lucky, but, it's pretty terrible to see from the outside how much Spain and Italy and then now the UK obviously are struggling with it. So, it's more so me asking how you guys are doing because it's more of a traumatic situation there.
Well, now things are getting better. And, step by step, I think things are going to be slow, but that's what we have to do. I mean, stay at home, it's easy for us.
Exactly.
I guess you have stay active during this quarantine.
Yeah, absolutely. I have to, working especially on my arms, you know, it's a summer body, but I don't think I'll ever be able to show them. But for me, it's, you know, I'm finished, or it was towards the end of the first season in Scotland. First experience for me in that country and that level. So you come off that season, let's just say it's finished, I don't know, but it's towards the end. And you realize what you need to improve. You make yourself some thoughts, some reflections on what you need to do. And one of them is building my physique in more. And then it's the mental thing. Decision-making is vital. And because this game is played in a different way than I'm used to. So you have to use that time effectively to prepare for the next season or the remaining 8 games, depending on what happens.
I'm going to ask you now about that, about the Scottish Premiership. But I want to ask you first, for example, Bundesliga, German football is coming back this weekend. Do you think the rhythm of the games are going to be like much slower than they were?
Yeah, that's a good question because, you know, you've been out for an extended amount of time. I think Bundesliga, they have such good players that, you know, will still be a high quality. And I think you, like anything, if you haven't done anything in a while, it takes a bit of time to get going. But then you find a rhythm. But I would be curious to see because, for example, in the case of Dortmund, who play at Signal Iduna Park with the yellow wall, you have 40,000. Mm-hmm. Of course, that affects you. Of course, that is an advantage. And if you don't play with that, if you're playing in front of an empty stadium, it's different, you know.
Yeah.
And people and players have said that. So I wonder, you know, how the players will cope with that. And then I wonder also for the fans. We're very excited about football returning. But how long will we be excited about seeing a game being played from in front of an empty stadium? Because it won't be the same, you know, because football needs the fans. And so it'll be interesting to see. But I think the players will find a rhythm, but it's more so going from playing in front of 30, 40, 50, 60, 70,000 to playing in front of the camera people, you know, and that will be the most interesting to see.
That's going to be different, obviously.
Yeah.
But from the player's perspective, do you think a preseason is needed?
Yeah, absolutely. Preseason is needed. Yeah, you're kidding me. Because you can also train as much as you want and run as much as you want. And sure, that will get you, that will give you an advantage coming in. But it can't compare to the rhythm you get in training, in games. You have to play games. You have to be constantly on it. And now everyone's doing their bit, but it's about coming back, finding that chemistry again, finding your sharpness. Because I think the sharpness is what you lose because things are going quick. You have to be ready. And for example, my position is center back, you know, and positioning and all that. So you need to come back to that rhythm. And therefore you can't just say, hey, listen, we're ready to play next week. Let's go play. No, we need at least like 3-4 weeks, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm with you in that.
Yeah.
We have talked a bit about the Scottish Premiership, the situation. We don't know that much from the league.
No, it's...
The players, you are getting information from, I don't know, the government or the federation?
Yeah, I mean, we get from the PFA, which is the players' organization. We get updates on it at the very least, and they're great at that. It's a long story, but there's several reasons why Scottish FA, the Football Federation, haven't started tackling the issue of whether to resume the season or end it because there's been some complications with votes on whether to abandon the season or not, whether to restructure the league and add another two teams in the league. Rangers have threatened to sue the Scottish government, or not government, but the FA, because of allege is corruption. And then the FA said, no, there is no corruption. And then that was voted down, back and forth. So now they're confronting the issue, whether to continue the season or not. But it won't be restructured because they said the most important thing is to resume play. And we can't afford tackling another issue, which is restructuring, you know. So we'll see now. But Scotland and England, obviously part of the UK, the Premier League is resuming now. The Championship, I think, will resume, but League One and League Two in England will not because they don't have the financial or the logistical measures to continue play. And Scotland and the teams and the resources are kind of in that same boat, because Premier League has the money to go back. Mm-hmm. La Liga, you know, you'd think has the money. Serie A, whatnot, Bundesliga, to go be tested every day, whatnot. But for many other clubs, for most clubs, that is difficult, because like any other business, they're struggling with money.
Mm. And people might know you play for Hamilton this season. Well, first of all, are you happy there? How is the experience?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, for me, you got to remember, I'm a different case. I'm 26 now. But I have always thought of myself as a late bloomer, in the sense that I've always developed or peaked a bit later. So I went to college in America for 4 years and played college football there. Incredible experience. And the facilities are like Premier League standard, La Liga standard. And then I went to New Zealand. And New Zealand is an amazing experience, but it's not a football country, so it's different. And then I go to Scottish Premiership because I went on a trial there and I got a contract. And it's a different level. It's a different kind of physique. Football, yes, it's everything you think of it is pretty much right. They're good players, but it's also a lot of 1v1, a lot of headers, yeah. a lot of physical, all that. So that's been a transition, because I've played in other countries and another level. So for me, it's been a matter of adapting to how the football is played. Maybe under pressure, it's often the long ball in behind. It's often just a clearance, just to get it on. And to get you need to play to get used to that. So by playing, you develop. But in order to develop, you need to play, you know. So it's been incredible experiences for me. I've been able to play against Celtic. I've been able to play against Rangers at Ibrox, and play against Defoe. He's got a hat-trick then, but we won't talk about that too much. And it's been incredible. Played at some great stadium parts, Hibernian. And Scottish football is proper. You know, we think of football as English, like the proper old-school football being played. And growing, I'm born in England. So to go back there and go back to the UK and play has been a dream of mine, and to be able to do it and be a part of that is something I'm very proud of, and I'm happy to do it for another season at least.
Well, now we're going to talk about Hamilton, but you have mentioned Rangers and Celtic. Mm-hmm. What do you think those kind of teams, Scottish teams, the last step, what do you think they need to compete in Europe?
It's tough, because to be fair, Rangers and Celtic did pretty well in Europe, you know. They won their group, Celtic. Rangers, I think, won their group or was second, but at least. And then they advanced and beat Braga, and then they met Bayer Leverkusen. But Bayer Leverkusen is fifth in the Bundesliga, so it's what should be expected. Celtic were disappointed not to qualify for Champions League, beat by Cluj, but then they go in the Europa League, and then they win the group, and they win against Lazio away. And got big Lazio at home, and we all know how Lazio is doing in the Serie A. They're contending for the title. So there's definitely that, but who knows? You know, Celtic and Rangers are working at a totally different level than Hamilton, you know, in terms of budgets and therefore players and all that. So it's hard to say where they benefit from, you know, an even tougher league. But I think they've proven that being in the league that they are, you know, then they are tested at times in the Premiership. You know, we were close to getting a result from them. So they're proven that they can do it in Europe. So it shouldn't be an excuse, and they have plenty of players to do so. So it's a matter of, you know, maybe a luck of the draw, but I think they've proven that they can take the level. And that's inspiring for someone like myself and for other teams to know, you know, you're competing against a high European standard.
And, well, Hamilton is on the 11th position right now. You are, you can tell us better, but you are now ready to play. If the season is over, what is going to happen? Because you are in position to play the playoff to avoid relegation. So I don't know. Yeah. What can you tell us?
Well, it would be exciting to see. You know, like you said, we're in the playoff position. 4 points ahead of Hearts, who've had a pretty underwhelming season so far. So 4 points ahead of them. It was massive. The last two games, we beat Rangers away 1-0, and we beat... Kilmarnock at home. So those were vital for us in case they were to say, you know, the season's done. Then, you know, we're in the 11th spot. You know, it's a tough thing because we play three more. If we were to continue the season, it would be three more games, and then they split the league in half, and the top six play each other, and the bottom six play each other. And that is a dogfight. That is a scrap. That is real tough because you're playing against all the teams around you. So, listen, we have no other choice but to prepare for that, if that were to be. But Hamilton's used to this, you know. It's the seventh season. Seventh straight season. Everyone always wants to predict Hamilton down. Everyone says Hamilton's small. Everyone doesn't like Hamilton because we're a small club, but we always stay up, and we plan on doing the same. And we're used to this, unlike, you know, another club below us who isn't as much. So that's what we take strength from, and it's an advantage for us.
You have the spirits.
Exactly. We're the spirits. And, you know, you see when you play with Hamilton on FIFA and all that, you understand, like, we're used to being in, like, down there in the nitty-gritty, but we show great character and resolve, and that's unique about the club because it's a proper tight-knit and small club. And, you know, there's a lot of bigger clubs down in the divisions in Scotland, but they're still there and we're still up, and there's a reason for that, you know. So people can talk as much as they want, but that's the case.
What a statement, huh?
Yeah, exactly. And everyone loves an underdog story. Everyone loves an underdog story when Hamilton, you know, goes to the final in this FIFA tournament. And, you know, everyone loves that.
It was great. It was great. But I want to know about your opinion, honest opinion about what do you think is going to happen? It's going to be the FA is going to say, we have to play the rest of the games, or they are going to void the season?
I think certainly the goal, in an ideal world, they would like to continue the season. But like I said earlier as well, there's a difference between having a preference and just not simply having the money for it. Some clubs don't have the option but to maybe say, cancel the season. We need our end of season profits to stay afloat, to survive. And that is the greater challenge because clubs, if the Bundesliga didn't return, for example, because they were still owed TV money, a third of the 36 clubs in the first and second Bundesliga could have faced bankruptcy. And that's in the Bundesliga and the second Bundesliga. So imagine for other clubs, you know. Yes. So, you know, you're dependent on getting money in, whether that be end of season, you know, money or whatnot, or to start the next season. But, you know, it's tough and you're putting quite the financial strain if you're requiring clubs to test and all that. So it's really tough. Because ideally, you do want to continue this season because, you know, clubs still have a chance of winning the league or staying up and not and avoiding relegation. So, of course, you ideally want this, but this is an imperfect world. And so it's really tough on the people making the decision what to do because there's so many factors. And then if you continue the next in this season, what about the people's contracts that expire? You know, in Scotland, contracts expire on the 31st of May. So what do you say then? Okay, we'll sign you to a short-term contract. Okay, but what if I already signed for another club? I don't want to play with you because I risk injury. So, yeah, but you kind of have to finish the season. Yeah, but that's, you know, so there's so many complications. So who's to say? But, you know, you've got to do what's handed to them. But you can see, like a case of Bundesliga, you see the importance of good leaders and you see the importance of a government that is able to take the necessary measures to move on. And Germany is a great example of that.
So do you think it's going to be void season?
Honestly, I cannot. I do not think we will finish the season. I do not think so. So I think it would end. And I think we would return for the following season, whenever that is.
The fact that you right now are in Norway.
Yeah.
Well, it's...
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. I mean, now the UK, finally, after everyone else, said 2 weeks of quarantine when you come to the country. So that is another factor. So we'll see how that works and whether maybe I'd have to return a bit before so I could stay in quarantine. And then after quarantine, I can go to training. But right now, no one knows when to return, and it's hard to say because we would have met up at the end of June, middle of June for the next season. That was the plan if this wouldn't have happened. So we'll see if that's the same case now.
Interesting. Well, you have mentioned, I have here a question talking about New Zealand, because you have played in New Zealand, and that's something probably strange for people. That's not,
yeah, absolutely.
Players are not used to play there.
Yeah.
But I want to know, you talk about the rhythm, about the fight here in Scotland, mm-hmm. but what do you think is the main difference between football in New Zealand and Scottish football?
Well, let's be frank, like, and be honest here, you know, the level is higher in Scotland. There's no doubt. But people tend to think when they go to New Zealand, yeah, New Zealand, that's a rugby country. That is, you know, what kind of football is there? But don't underrate it, because it's not the A-League in terms, because the A-League has the resources in place and they have franchise teams. But New Zealand has a lot of cool players and a lot of good players. And the players I played with there, a lot of them were Irish. They had an Irish head coach with experience from the League of Ireland. One played in the Europa League against against Rosenborg and whatnot. And you played against other players in the league who've had experience from Europe. And the team that won the league when I was there, a young team with full of Kiwis, which I call them, people from New Zealand, they went on to they were part, half of them were part of the New Zealand under-20s who played in the World Cup. And they qualified from the group, eliminating, amongst other things, Norway and Holland playing there, for instance. So they have a lot of young, good talents coming up. And, you know, you had that in one part of the team, and then you had other teams that had other more experienced and good players. Some played in Spain. There was Auckland, which is, you know, one of the bigger teams. Mm-hmm. They had a few Spanish players there with experience from the Spanish league system. So you played against some good teams, and then it's a matter of the consistency and all that. But I enjoyed my time there, and I met some incredible people, and I was able to, my life philosophy, you know, is be able to experience things and go out of my comfort zone as much as possible. And so to be able to merge my life philosophy with a football experience and have them be part of the same one was incredible for me. And so I was able to do that, and I had only 7 months there, but I made some friends for life. And New Zealand is a very beautiful country too. So I had that experience too.
And you have gone through as well North American football. You have played for Duke University. That is one of the biggest in basketball terms. I want to ask you, because we talked about this a few weeks ago with a man who lives in Miami. And I want to know your opinion. You've been inside North American football. I know it's university level, but still North American football. How do you think the football, or soccer, how they like to call it there, is developing in the last few years?
You know, it's funny, because I had this chat with my coach yesterday, and I followed it quite a bit in America. And I would say that American soccer, which we'll call in this case, is growing tremendously. And I think you can see the overall package around the MLS now is very exciting. You know, the resources in place, the stadiums, the players, everything is becoming bigger. And past are the days where you get in, and I love these players, don't get me wrong, but the Pirlo and the Lampards and all that, who are 35 and they're thinking, okay, like, let me do, have a year or two here. They're bringing in, like, they changed their transfer philosophy. They're bringing young players from South America and selling them, because MLS is struggling a bit. Do they want to be a buying league? Do they want to be a selling league? But they want to be a selling league too. You see Alphonso Davies in Bayern as well. And so I think the MLS is an incredible, incredible thing to follow, because it brings also the, what I love about America, is, and that is the show and the entertainment to it. And they're great at branding teams, and they're great at creating a show around the team. But also, the academies and stuff are being professionalized. And in my, you know, experience with the universities and college, people underrate it. And I think more and more foreigners are starting to understand it too, because I'm like, the resources there, I can explain to you this for weeks, but you have to understand, you have to see it to understand actually how, we're talking like Premier League facilities, and a lot of it's enabled by basketball, Duke basketball, which is a great institution. You have Coach K there and everything.
Yeah.
That's an incredible institution, which allows us but to have those resources in part, but we have, you know, donors and whatnot. And we're playing, we have like the best of facilities. Everything a top club can imagine. And I played against a lot of players, people that came from England, people that came from Spain, Italy, whatnot. And the level is good. And you're competing against some good players there. You know, I've seen a fair amount of them go pro. And so people shouldn't think, oh, when I go to college, that's like me giving up on my football career or whatnot. It's possible. It's tougher because you have school and you need to be more responsible with what you prioritize. But it is possible. And, you know, I like to think of myself an example of that. And I had formed some of the best years of my life there. You know, I was happy to do that. And then I was able to be part of the MLS draft as well and be part of that whole draft system, which I think is, you know, is so typically American. But being part of that and going to Orlando then and then being drafted. And unfortunately, that didn't work out because that's football. But it was a great experience nonetheless.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have mentioned one English team, and I have heard Arsenal is looking for defenders. So maybe
No, they've looking for defender for 10 years now. You know? So, hasta luego, my friends.